We're going to be talking about CIMON's HMI software today, and its name is XpanelDesigner Designer. We're going to go over the basics, and this is what it looks like. So on the left is just the XpanelDesigner by itself. So a nice little piece of hardware that you could put in your factory line and increase your automation's needs. And then on the right, we have an HMI plus PLC combo. So I have an actual one with me right now, but this is an image. It's a little fatter than you would see on a normal HMI because it's hosting a PLC inside. And then right here, as you can see, there's an expansion module that you can hook up to three modules here to increase your IO point need. So I'm going to unshare real quick and then show you what a real one looks like. All right, so it's about this size. I don't know if you already saw it. And then it has a lot of neat connectors, serial port, Ethernet, USB, mini USB-B. We have a run and stop mode for the PLC. And then it's a relay type PLC inside, so 8 inputs and 8 outputs. And then you can see the expansion comes from right here. We put a module right here, and then we can expand 2 more on top of that one module, so for a total of 3 expansions. And then we also have the drilling points here for the VESP mounts. Okay. Back to the presentation. The next in line, we have some other products. Going to just glance right over them. We have a SCADA product called Ultimate Access, so more of a controlling point software. And then we also give out IPCs, so, and then that can come already attached with a SCADA. And then this is our PLC family lineup, just to let you know that we also do have PLCs as a distribution. And then an overall layout of a factory line networking. So this is where your XpanelDesigner would come in play. It would retrieve data as a client from server. So it would get maybe communication from a bunch of sensors or switches or what have you, and it communicates directly with the PLC if it needs to. And then it can itself, it can act as a server, and then the SCADA can be the client pulling data from the XpanelDesigner itself. So it can be a server and a client all in one. So just a little bit about the basics of XpanelDesigner. When you see the hardware and you want to, and you're inside a program like this and you want to close it, so you're going to click the bottom left corner of the XpanelDesigner, then you're going to hear a beep and then a gray square is going to pop up like that. And then you're going to click the bottom right and then the gray square is going to pop up. And then you're going to click the top right and then gray square is going to pop up. And then you get this menu that pops up right here. And right here, you can press the exit button and you can go to the normal desktop screen to mess around with other features. But this is a little proprietary function that CIMON has developed. Other little basics for XpanelDesigner Designer would be, when you launch the program, make sure that you run it as administrator. I'm going to show you a workaround for that. But for starters, you're going to get the software like this. It's going to be a zip file, and then you're going to want to extract it. And then you're going to run the executable. It's just one file, and then it'll be easy to download. And then after that, go to properties, or you can file location first. Then you can go to properties, and you can go to details or compatibility, change the settings for all users, run this program as administrator, apply, OK, OK out. And then it will always run as administrator. The reason I tell you to run it as administrator is because when you do your project, you're going to want to simulate it. You're not going to just want to throw it onto the hardware immediately. You're going to want to test it. So therefore, running it as administrator will allow you to run the simulator. All right. So that was just a little bit basics about running as administrator, getting the software, downloading it, and then also being able to shut down a program once you've installed it onto the hardware itself. So going back into the presentation. So we're going to go over a lot of these beautiful features today. First up is going to be database. So the basic foundation of the whole project. We're going to create so many variables for you. And then we're also going to go through the script feature, trend, data logging, alarm, reporting, and security. So for the database, we're going to create a basic backbone for our program. We're going to make a program here, and then we're going to upload it to the HMI and just see how it works right at the get-go. In seconds, within an hour, we're going to develop a program and then upload it to the HMI, and it works magnificently. So We have some tag names here on the left side. So we're going to name our tags tag 0 through tag 5. They're going to have some behaviors. We're going to name the descriptions for these so you know, you have a reminder for yourself. Oh, what did I want tag 3 to do? Oh, I wanted tag 3 to generate a random value between min and max. What's my min and max? Oh, it's over here. I'll make two tags, call min, or I'll call one tag min and make it initial value 0, and then I'll make another tag called max, initial value 200. So I have a min and a max for the project. And then I'll have stepping sizes. So based on some algorithm, one of these step sizes will get chosen, and then the values tag 0 through tag 2 will increase or decrease based on that stepping size. So instead of actually doing this on a normal PLC right now, I'm just going to show you on the simulation software, and then we'll show you on the hardware aspect. So in the XPanel Designer itself, you're going to see a toolbar like this. The database is this tag-looking feature. They're called tags, so therefore the icon looks like a tag, like a tag you would put on a keychain or something. That's what we call for our database. Inside the database, you're going to see windows like this. So let's go over each 1 through 7. Let's go over each number. So the first one, we're going to create a tag. And when you press the create a tag button, it's going to pop up with this edit tag interface. And we can name it anything we want here. And then the type, we want to make it a group, it'll be a folder. We want to make it a digital, it'll understand ones and zeros. If it wants to be analog, it'll understand multiple variables or multiple values. And if we want it to be a string, it'll understand words and characters in a sequence. So number 4, if we want to determine, if we want to test it out or if we want it to be a memory bit, we could have it be a memory bit by making it a virtual tag and then hosting it on a data server. So when the HMI gets used as a server, the client will grab data using that IO address in the data server. We'll go over that later though. Then for real tag, this would be if the HMI was acting as a client grabbing data from a server. So we would use the real tag. And then the IO device right here is where you set up, IO device is where you choose where you set up an IO device. So if for our case, I'm going to show you that we're going to be setting up to a PLC-S, which is already inside the hybrid. As we mentioned before, the hybrid is a PLC plus an XPanel combo. And then we'll have the IO addresses, which basically tells you which memory register to look at to grab that data from, whether it be digital, analog, or string. And then we have this retention feature right here, number 7. We can save last status when closing. So even when you close the program, it remembers what the value was, so retention. So that's a little bit about the database. And then this is what an actual, or this is what we're going to be setting up. So we're going to go edit the tags, and then we're going to input these features. And I created a notepad, little notes for us to make sure it's done easily. So then let's go into the database. So this is what the project looks like finished. So I'm going to open up a completely new one so we can see what it looks like to go from start to finish. So run as administrator, as we said before. I want to create a new project. Press new project. Project name, I'm going to name it demo purposes. And then project description, tutorial. And then for work in, it'll tell you where the files are going to save to. It's going to save into the XPanel Designer files, which is correct. And then we can choose the type of XPanel we want here. So then we have a bunch of screen sizes to choose from. We have the 4-inch, the 7-inch, the 10-inch, 12-inch, and the 15-inch. A lot of these have been discontinued, so sorry about that. But for our purposes, we're going to be choosing the 7-inch. And we have this little feature over here that tells us if we want to choose between a hybrid or not. When you check this hybrid box, it automatically assigns the serial communication port to the PLC because that's how the hybrid works. It's communicating the PLCS inside of the hybrid as serial communication, 232 or 485. Sorry. And then I'm going to click on the hybrid because that's what we were going to work on in the first place. Press OK. And then we get our canvas to work in. So our first page prompts, and then we want to name it something. I'm going to name it demo. And I want to get started. So I'm going to go to the database section right here. And then I'm gonna start making my tags. First tag I wanna make, inputs. So input, I'm gonna make it a group because I want it to host multiple variables inside this. It's not, itself is not gonna be a tag, but it's going to be a group tag. So it's gonna host a collection of tags within itself. So it's more of an indexing. So we're gonna add to the input, we're gonna add tag 0. We're gonna make it analog. And then we're gonna make it a virtual tag for the purposes of this presentation. And then so forth. You would do tag 0 to tag 1 to tag 5. I'm gonna go ahead and do tag 4 and make it digital because that's what we declared it to be. And there's nothing really to do in advanced. And in analog advanced, there is plenty to do. So we can have it be an unassigned 16 integer, which would make sure it has no negative. The 16th bit is not used for a negative. It's rather it's used for the actual value of 32, 6, 7, 8, I think. And then if we want it to be integer 16, it would actually assign that bit to be a negative. So we could have our negative ranges to our positive ranges. So then that's how you create a tag, analog and digital. And then we're going to move along. So far, that's what it looks like in our demo purposes. And then I'm going to show you what it's like in the rest of it. So this is the main feature here. And then the database somewhat looks like this. So I have three groups here. I have an input, stepping size, and then I have a range, min and max. This is what we talked about earlier, 0 to 200. And then the stepping sizes of 5, 10, and 20. And then we're going to have zeros as the initial values for all the tags, and then the descriptions are over here as seen. Step up to the max, then step up to the down. So this reminds me what the tag is used for in the first place. And it's pretty good for troubleshooting, right? So I have the description of the first page right here, input tag 0, the value will show right here, and then the description I have put next to the name of the tag. Back to the presentation. So that's a little bit about the database. We have created the foundation for our program. We have input tags 0 through 5, 0 through 3 being analog and setting the ranges between 0 to 200. And then for input tag 5 and 4, we've made those digital. One second, let me show one more thing. When you're inside the tag database and you're looking at analog tags, and in the advanced features, you can actually change the min and max value down here. I didn't show that. But the min and max value, to make sure it doesn't reach outside of that range for you, you can set it for yourself. So that's a double, like a security feature on top of me already making a range 0 to 200. I don't want that tag ever getting out of that min and max mode. So going back to the presentation, we're done with the database. We've secured the foundation of our program. We're going to continue. So the scripting feature inside XPanel makes it very nice for operations to actually happen instead of creating long lists of ladder logic or creating or getting different types of hardware that just do one simple task that costs lots of money. You can have script actually compose that whole feature for you. So our scripting feature is in C language script. So I don't know if you guys are familiar with that, but we also have a lot of useful guides in our help manual to help you become not proficient at C language, but utilize it in our programming feature itself. So you don't have to be a master of C language to actually use our scripting feature. So the script will look something like this. This is the script I typed out for us inside the project. So what I'm gonna go through this little by little. So this means while this is true, this will always run. So while on off is equal to 1. So this is a switch I've made, an on off switch digital. So between 0 and 1. And while that digital switch is on, this whole script will run. So input tag 0 will be set to tag 0 plus 5. So this is plus 5, this is plus 10, this is plus 20. Input tag is a random value divided by 164. That gives us our random value between 0 and 32,000. That's actually how you do the random values with XPanel. I did change this, however, I'm going to show you that real quick, just so we can generate a random value for tag 5 much better. And then down here is a list of the scripting, so it changes conditions. So if this hits the max, then it will invert the stepping size. So it will turn 5 into negative 5, and then it'll go down all the way to the minimum, being 0. And then when it hits 0, it inverts again, and it goes back to positive 5. And then I did this for each of those stepping sizes. And then for here, this is just toggling between 0 and 1 for tag 4. So that tag is just toggling by itself. And then last but not least, we have this little sleep feature down here. So it's in milliseconds. So what this is saying is after this program runs, it doesn't run for another 100 milliseconds. It will pause for 100 milliseconds and then go through the script again. Pause, go through the script again. So let's go look at the script. So I assigned that one digital value to be random, but I thought of a better way to do it. So if we just declare one tag to be a random value, if the random value is above the halfway mark, it's a 0. If it's below that halfway mark, it's a 1. So this is a utilization of our if and else statements, which is pretty nice as well. It helped clear up that whole issue. But this one right here will show a decimal because it's actually doing the division. And I changed the sleep to actually be 1,000 milliseconds, so it's 10 seconds rather than being 0.1 seconds. All right, so we have the script feature, we have our tags. Now we need to set up our page and we need to set up tag values. So to display a tag value, we need to go to draw, and then we need to click on the dynamic tag feature, and then that will create a whole bot interface for us where we can assign whatever we want this object to do. So object 2 is going to have the style of a dynamic tag. It's going to have the tag value be input tag 3, and then that's it for this feature. That's all we're showing. We just want it to display a number. We're not going to have anything special with it. So moving on to other drawing features, we're going to add a switch and a lamp. So when I press the switch or lamp, it's going to turn that bit that we talked about, the on and off switch, to the on mode and to the off mode. So when it's set to 1, it will run that whole script. When it's set to 0, it won't run that script. And you can see down here that there's a special function command. So you can't just call a script, or you can't just expect a script to run after something becomes true, unless it's always running and then it waits to be something to become true. So in my case, I didn't do that. I just made a special function command to call upon that script because I don't want it to be running in the background needlessly. So when this bit is switched, at the same time, it calls upon that script and it runs it. So it will run because it was switched to on and because it was called at the same time. And then when it's turned off, it will stop running that command because the bit's no longer 1. And then this is what that running the script demo looks like, because we named the script to be demo. And so when I press this button, it'll turn on and then it'll run this mini script right here. Notice that you will always need to follow up your scripts with a semicolon, or it'll be a syntax error, which is another beautiful feature with our XPanel Designer. If you're typing in something, it will not compile it unless the syntax is correct. And it will guide you to where to look at when the syntax is incorrect, which is pretty stellar. So going back to our XPanel, let's look at what some of the things that we created. Okay, so for here, these are just text files or text. So I'm clicking up here for a text, and then I just click down here and I can start typing in it. And then that becomes part of the whole file. It stays there and text is like that. So these are both text setups. And then this is our dynamic tag that we were talking about. So if I go to draw, dynamic tag, and then I click anywhere, I can choose the tag that I want to show here. So if I want it to show random, it'll show random. And any value that random becomes will display on these question marks. So that's how I'm displaying dynamic tags. That's how I'm displaying tag 0 through tag 5. And then this lamp up here, we call it a switch lamp. To get there, you go draw, then the switch lamp is right here, or you have a little toolbar feature right here that is a switch lamp. To turn that on, you have to checkbox this because it goes away otherwise. But drawing, we're gonna go to switch lamp, then that brings up this whole interface right here. And then we can declare what bit we want to be responsible for its on and off state. We can declare the function we want to call when if needed. Now, if you wanted to have two states, I have two states right here. I have an on and an off state. You need to go to the lamp you need to enable lamp, and then you need to choose the number of states to be 2. When you choose the number of states, you're going to have to assign the state to a bit status. Since we made it a digital tag, we need to pick a digital tag. So in my case, on and off is a digital tag. So that is how I made my button value and how I made my tag values or dynamic tags. So to kind of see what's going on here, so we've made the tag, we made the tag foundation, we created buttons, we created dynamic tags, we created a script. So what's left, we need to set up the page so we can see what it looks like. So when you click this button up here, this starting page, it's initially gonna be like this. By default, it chooses none. So you're gonna have to choose which page you want to be the starting page when it's ran. Then you press okay, and that's good. So we're gonna run this via simulator just to see what it's like. So it's displaying zeros right now, and that is correct because it's not on, and the initial values were set to 0. So I'm going to press this button, and it's gonna start doing those features we were talking about. It's adding 5 right here. It's adding 10, it's adding 20. These are random values between 0 and 200. And then this is toggling between 0 and 1, and this is randomly assigned a 0 or a 1 based on what value this is. So this is my random tag. So if this is above 16,000, it'll be a 0. If it's below 16,000, it turns into a 1. So half the time it's 0, half the time it's 1. So essentially it's a random 0 or 1. The way that I made 0 to 200 random was I took 32,000 and I divided it by 200. And then I got 140 something, and I chose that as my factor, which scaled down my range. So it scaled it from 0 to 32,000 to 0 to 200. And I'll show you that right here, just to clarify. So in my script, I said, take the random value and divide it by 164. So 164 times 200 turns out to be 32,000 something. So then that's the how you would condense the range to be between your two set values. Otherwise, if you're trying to do a random digital, you can do greater than or less than 16,000. Okay, going back to the presentation, we have seen what it looks like. Okay. So we created a little lamp, made it go off and on, wanted to see what it looks like. It generated all those values. When I turned it off, it stopped producing those values and so forth. This is just reiterating that how to choose the different states. When I choose the different states, I press open. So like after I go to the lamp and I choose two different states and I come here, I can do shape select, press the open button when I click on one of these, and it'll give me a wide range of stuff to choose. So for example, I click on state 1 and I want to pick something else. I have all these other beautiful buttons to choose from to be that feature, and it will change by itself. So if I press OK and save, we're going to run this as administrator. This will be a yellow button now. And when I turn it off, all the numbers stop moving. So this is essentially keeping the script running or closing it. Okay, so we have gone over how to choose the different states for our lamps. Pretty cool stuff. So the main view, this is what it should look like. This is what I've shown you it looks like. And when you press this button, these numbers start lighting up. On the HMI, it looks different. It's not cut off right here. You can probably see that it's cut off right here. It's actually not cut off. So let me show you that real quick. See that it's rounded there at the end. So sometimes, not all the time, does it display the correctness on the XPanel, and you might have to work around with it, or you might play to your benefit like I did for me. All right, share screen. All right, okay, so this is what the main view looked like. You did all these tags, all the values show up, et cetera, et cetera. Now, I showed you this where we do the XPanel setup. This is how you pick your starting page. If you don't pick a starting page, it's gonna prompt you and be like, well, you didn't pick a starting page, you have to, or we won't do anything. So if you don't choose a starting page, you will get error messages and another syntax checking for you. So this is how we chose it. We clicked this little button right here, picked on the starting page dropdown, and then picked main view. So we're going to jump into trend views. We want to be able to see our historical data. We don't want to know what just a value is at a given moment in time. We want to know what it was in the past and what it was between then, all points in time. Very particular about seeing all the data, right? So the way to do that is to go to draw, go to the trend graph. When you see, when you press the trend graph, you'll get this dialog box to open. You can press YT. This is the most generic way to map the values for a graph. I mean, there are other options, but for the purposes of a basic introduction to XPanel, we're just going to go over YT. So for YT, I've set some tags over here. So tag 0, tag 1, tag 3, tag 2. If you notice, these are the analog values between 0 and 200. So these values will jump up and down to 200. And I have, you, when you press the 1 here, you're going to choose the value, the color, and then this is the nickname. This isn't actually the tag. The tag name is input because that was the group name, dot tag name. So input folder, dot, and then this tag inside of that folder. So let's go into XPanel real quick. All right, so I made a new page to make the trends. To do that, you just go up here to new page, and then you can name it whatever you want, and then it creates that new page, and then there you go. That's how you would generate a new page. For me, I did trends, it's right up here. I don't want that page anymore. I don't want this page anymore. So it goes away. Anyway, on to trends. When I press draw trend graph, excuse me, you would get this option up here. So I pick all this, all these features. Just click anywhere. So I picked YT. I want it to save to the main memory when this does. Just for this purposes, I'm not going to choose SD or USB. And then I want it to display from the right side. So it, the data is coming from the right side and it's trickling to the left. And then the sampling time. It's going to take a piece of data, or it's going to log or pull a piece of data every second. So 10 times 100 is 1,000, 1,000 milliseconds is 1 second. So every second, it's going to be pulling whatever that tag value is and then log it. And then the display time, it's going to show 2 minutes from here to here. But this isn't the options for that one. I changed that one to be a minute. So if we go here, you can see that I changed it to be a minute right here. I want it to be pulling data every second. Object style, I want the color to be white. Background color, white. We want a fixed pin, because if it's a moving pin, it's gonna go like this. It's gonna move from left to right on its own and generate the graph, which, I mean, that's preferences. If you like it, you like it. You can use that, but that's what it's used for. Then we have our tag values. So when I click, this is what I wanted to show you in the first place. If I click this, this lets me pick my tag value. So go here, input folder, pick my tag. It chooses it. I can comment it, nickname it, or remind myself why I'm using this in the first place. Declare its min and max. This min and max right here changed the y-axis. This is not the same min and max that you have in your tag database controlling that tag value. This min and max actually changes the y-axis of here. So if I were to put a 400, this would change to 400 right here. But then I would have to change all of these to 400. So I have set 200 to each of them. So that's why the very max is 200. If I were to change one of them to 400, and I click on that tag value, when I generate that value, it will scale to graph to 400, and then everything else will be a 200, but you'll see a 400 up here, and the graph will just look scaled down. So showing the control buttons, these control buttons down here, they will be shown as long as this is checked. So this will let you configure your graph. So you can check to click off certain tags if you don't want to see them. This right here will change the color. So it will change it from tag 0 to tag 1 to tag 2 if you want to view it in different terms. Like I was saying, the y-axis gets scaled based on the max of whatever the tag value is inside this dialog box. Plus and minus magnification will let you scale in to the history. So you can see the data every second, or you can see the data every hour. You can just change it in like going smaller and bigger. And then left and right will choose, like if you've been running this for an hour, say, and you're only showing the 2 minute frame, you can go back in segments of 2 minutes within that whole hour to see what was happening. Or you can pause it and type in the time you want to view at explicitly. You can control what time of the data you've been logging to see that. And then we have a legend. So we can display the tag value. We can show the date, which we are. And then the format is month or year, month, date up here, year, month, date. And then the grid, we can just, the color of the grid is black. So these lines, and then display the grids. How many columns do I want? Do I want five? So, or how many lines do I want? Not columns or rows. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then for the Y axis, I can display the min and max values. So this is what I was talking about. And then this X axis, we can display the time. So to actually see what this looks like in process, let's go. So it's already running. All right, so I turned it on. I want to see what's going on with those values historically. Well, here we go. I can kind of see right here what's actually happening. If I increase the size, I can see what's happening in a smaller time frame. And you can see over here, the ones and the zeros going up and down. I changed the min and max to be 1.25 and negative 0.25 to really show what it's doing. Because if you make it 0 and 1, it just looks like a line hitting the top and bottom. It doesn't really, it doesn't look professional. So I changed the scaling to really show the zeros and one going up and down. And then over here, you'll see the analog values. So the blue, the red, and the light blue line will always be looking like this fashion because that's how the script runs. So to kind of show what I was talking about, this will change the color. So notice how it changed to light blue. When it changes to light blue, this value will change too. It accommodates everything for that change. And then I can configure it as well. If I want the time limit to be less, or the least amount you can do is 1 minute, but if I want the time limit to be more, I can. I can choose this time limit to be 2 minutes, and then it will reconfigure this to 2 minutes after I zoom out all the way. So now it's at 2 minutes. If I configure it again, back down to 1 minute, it should change it. And there it goes. It automatically configured it to 1 minute in between. And then if I don't want it to show this random line, this green line that's all over the place because it's a random value every second, I can check it to go away. And then it disappears from the graph. So I can see a more stable graph of where my lines and my trends are actually at. Same thing for this graph. I can make pen 2 go away, and I can actually see the alternating between the zeros and the 1 of tag 4. Okay. So going back to the presentation, we have went through the trend view, how we pick our values to be on the graph itself, what kind of graph we should choose, and how we display that graph, and where the sampling time and the display time is. This is what the graphs look like, this is what I showed you, and it's what a beautiful work of art, honestly. So for data logging, we're going to choose this little feature right here. And we can pick specific tag values to log every second, every 2 seconds, just so we can just pinpoint what is that data doing? What is it doing this whole time? So the way you do that is you click this button up here, this data log button, and then it's going to prompt you with this interface, and then you're going to name it whatever you want. So I'm in it, for our purposes, I'm naming it tag1_log. And when it is called upon, so meaning a command script is punched in or a command script button is pressed. No, ignore that. That was part of the feature. When tag 0 hits 160, then it writes a CSV. It's an alarm thing. We'll go through that later in the presentation. Just ignore that little button. So when tag 1 log is... So when tag 1 is called upon, this log is called upon, it will start logging data to a CSV file, periodic and daily. So I'm going to choose it to be a period of 1 second. So every 1 second, it's going to pull whatever data that tag is. And then it's going to make the data that, or it's going to make the file types daily file types. So it'll be, for instance, for today, it'll be 4:09. And then tomorrow it will make a separate file 4:10. And then the day after it will make 4:11 for you if you choose to do it that way. And then down here we have the maximum number of per block, and then the maximum number of blocks. So the way to call this tag into play is to actually write in a button command expression. The action has to be changed from the dropdown to command expression. We're going to write in there data log parentheses colon or apostrophes. These are the most important part of the whole script. If you don't write this, it will always be a syntax error. So apostrophes tag 1 underscore log apostrophe comma 1. Put a space in here. You don't have to, but it looks neater when you put a space. Parentheses and then a semicolon. So what this is saying is when this is activated, it's going to start logging tag 1 data because it's being called to action. And it will start doing it every second and it'll start making daily files of it. So if I want to go further and I want to actually see something on my XPanel, not just a CSV file that's going to be stored to the local database or to a USB or SD card, I actually want to see something physical on the screen, I can pick this data log box down here, and then it's going to give me this dialog box as well. So I need to put the name of my log model, which was the tag 1 log, that was the name. You don't actually write that in. Drop down right here will let you pick from it, so you don't have to remember your log name or how many underscores do I have? Did I use a 1 or an I? So forth. You can just drop down, pick your log name right there. And then you can choose the number of rows and columns you want. Do you want them to be equally distant, or do you want them to be, you want to customize your logs? For our purposes, I just did equal. And then we have item settings, so we can make it year, month, date, and then we can display the date, the time, the maximum value, average, all these values. But I chose date and time. An average, I feel like that was the most important. And then it's going to be a continuous display instead of a block display. So what this does, when I press this button that I created in the previous slide, when I create this button, it's going to start populating this chart with numbers coming from top to bottom with the value of that tag. And I'm going to show you what that looks like. So for purposes of here, when I click this button and I go to trends, I want to see different numbers here. I don't want to just see zeros or whatever the number is stuck at. So I'm going to press this button. When I pressed this button right here, it started populating this chart with values. So it's keeping historical data for ease of access for yourself. You can control this to have as many columns as you want or many rows as you want. So you can see a long list of values, but you might get hit by the screens height capacity before you actually get hit by the internal column or the row capacity. So in terms of here, we just have the 5 slots, and down here, it's really cool. I like this average column. So it tells me the average of this column at any given moment in time. So going back to the presentation, we have created data logging, and then we created a button that controls data logging. So in terms of data logging, we're going to just to let you know that the values or the actual file itself gets stored in the root directory. So on this page right here, you see a USB file or a USB location. The tag 1 log got saved within the root file. It gets saved in within a folder, but that folder gets saved in the root directory. It doesn't go anywhere else. So if you're ever looking for it, just know to look in the root directory for your data. So moving on to alarm view, I want to actually, after we do alarms, then I'm going to show you the USB usage with the personal HMI I have here to show you the actual writing capability of our HMI. But let's go through the alarm, and then I'm going to show you on the HMI itself. So for alarm view, we're going to create alarms for tag 0 and tag 5, and then draw a summary view. So for tag 0, I want a high alarm, I want a high alarm, a low, and a low. So 160, 120, 80, and 40. And then for tag 5, I just want when it goes from off to on for there to be an alarm. So from when it goes from 0 to 1, it will create an alarm. The way to do that is to click on this alarm button right here, and then when we add an alarm, it'll create a dialog box with the features that you should choose to put inside. Let's go see what that is. So click on this, and then I'm going to add. And then this is what adding an alarm looks like. So I'm going to pick my tag. I want, say, tag 1 to trigger whenever it's greater than 1. Well, it's going to be triggering a lot because it's only ever less than 1 at one point, and that's when it's 0. So just letting you know that this value will trigger every time it's above 1, and then whatever happens when the alarm occurs, so if it opens a page or if it commands a script, etc. So this is our alarm feature. And then when I draw an alarm summary, I can choose what I want it to show in that summary. If I want alarm time, value, alarm status, alarm description. For our purposes, we're going to use alarm description as the name because you can't use device name unless you're actually talking to a physical I/O, so like a PLC or something, because it will just show zeros and ones because that's the internal storage memory for itself. So if you're going to use device name, just make sure that you're using a physical I/O device, pulling data from a PLC or something. So this is what the window looks like for the alarm view. It's going to show your times over here. It's going to show you the values, the warning or the types. So like whether it's a high, low, low, or you know, warning, clear, acknowledge, the descriptions over here. So I put the name of the tag for us, and then low, low, or low, or high, high, and then off and on. So let's go see what that looks like real quick. So to get the alarms to trigger, I have to push the button. So we're going to go to alarms, and this is what it's been pulling this whole time. So a bunch of off to on. When it goes green, that means the alarm has been cleared. That means there is no longer an active alarm. But we have this scrolling message down here that tells us when the alarm is on. So, and I've only done that for the off and on state. So this whole feature will happen. The scrolling message will stop as soon as I acknowledge this this instance. So as soon as it turns to blue, the scrolling will stop. As soon as this reaches all the way to the right, the whole button will disappear. So this is essentially our alarm view in a nutshell. And then last but not least, I want to be able to view my alarms, right? So the same thing when it came to data logging, we need a script to write when it comes to alarm view. So we have a button that we want to make. We want to do command expression alarm CSV write, and then it's going to be, it's been cut out here, so I'm going to write it again for you. It's alarm CSV. So one means alarm group one. It means 1 through 10, that group. And you can also type this script into the help manual and actually look for the characters that are inside the parentheses. We're going to name the folder alarm history. It's going to be docked into the USB 2, and then it's going to print all columns for me, and then it's going to save as well. So in terms of that, this is what it's going to look like. It's in my USB drive. It's named alarm history, has the time value. Sorry, this 2 refers to the time value. To show you what that looks like, let me show you. You can always use the help button. Looks good. All right, so these are the different time values or different time formats you can use. So we're using 2. So it's going to display it as month, date, year, hour, minute, second. So back to the presentation. It's year, month, day, and then hours, second, minute. But when it displays it down here, it does it how we want it to be. We want it to be month, day, year, hours, minute, second. And then it displays all these others. This is that alarm value I was talking to you about, the device value. It's internal storage. It doesn't actually tell you the name of the tag unless you're doing a physical inputs and outputs. So we can do scrolling messages, by the way. You can do tools, go to XPanel configuration. You have to checkbox the scrolling messages. When you do that, then a scrolling message tab shows up, and then you can choose what you want to, how you want it to scroll from left to right, right to left, top to bottom, bottom to top. So I'm going to go ahead and show you the CSV writing capability. So another little basics when it comes to the XPanel. Let me turn it off. First, I want to show you guys how to connect real quick to the XPanel. So if you're going to do it by USB, let me stop sharing real quick. If you're going to do it by USB, you're going to see this mobile web center show up on your screen. And it actually looks like this right here. So it's going to say connected once you've connected via USB mini B. And from here, I want to show you guys something. Let's see. Get right here. Stop share. Okay. So this button right here, if I press that. And then I'm going to go to trends. I'm going to press the button to start logging that data. But I'm going to input my USB stick first. Press that button. It will start logging the data for me. And then if I go to alarms, and I press the button down there, it will tell me that it actually wrote the CSV correctly. So I'm going to take the USB out of the XPanel now, and I'm going to input it into my computer, and we're going to see what happens. Look at that. All right, so then alarm history showed up. And then it generated my tag values and the times and dates and what's going on within said tag, why the alarm's being encountered and whatnot. So it will do it like this. It will store the data like this. This is what I wanted to actually show you. It stores in the USB drive. That's where I chose the direction to be. It'll save it in this format, and then it'll name it tag one log, which was the name of our whole log in the first place. So going through last part, or one of the last parts, security. So say you don't want someone logging into your stuff and you want to set some guidelines on who has what capabilities, you need to use the security feature. So right here, this little guy right here in a business suit, looks like he's a bodyguard or something. Now we can create users and logins. So in terms of XPanel, lowest privilege level is 1, highest privilege level is 10. So what that means is if you set the privilege, if you set security level to 2, someone has to be 2 or higher to access that. If they're lower than 2, a 1 or a 0, they won't have access to anything. So I've created 2 users over here, an admin with level 10 and then a basic with level 0. Basic has no password. For admin, I put a password of 123 for us. One second. And then we need a button to log on with. So we create a push button, name it log on when, parentheses, parentheses, semicolon, and then this will generate a button for us to log in with. So let's go look at that. Let's see what that looks like. I'm on the main menu and I want to log in. So this button over here, I've created a security feature. If you're not a 10 or if you're not higher than a 1, you can't access this button. So current security level is too low. Anytime I press it, current security level is too low. But when I log in, when I press that login button, this is what generates a user ID. So you can pick between the already populated one. You don't have to input anything. So you choose admin, 1, 2, 3, press OK. Now I can press this button. Now I have the right to press this button. But as soon as I go into basic, it will log me out of admin, and then I can't press this button anymore because I'm a basic user, I'm not admin. So going back to the presentation, last but not least, or one of the last things we're gonna be showing today is the page properties. We're gonna double click on an empty space on the page and bring up the page window properties. So the best part about this is where we can name anything we want. We can name the page to be anything we want. We can describe the page to remind ourselves what we're accomplishing with this page. Change the background color. The security level is what I was referring to down here. So if I made the security level 1, the person who was basic would not be able to access that page no matter what. They'd have to be logged in to someone with a one or a higher. And then we can also do page position, which I will show you what that looks like. Like anywhere on the back part. So page position will tell you how the page should be ran. So it should, the position is at 00, so up here is 00, and then it's within a type, and you can copy those dimensions over, and it will run on the XPanel like that. Just a little bit more, and we're almost done. So for the communication part, with the hybrid, it's already communicating when you choose the hybrid. It's communicating via serial, and it's communicating RS-232. And then you're just going to double check your communication port on the PLC part, but it'll auto-configure for you when you choose the hybrid I/O in the beginning of creating the project. When you check that box, it'll develop this little I/O device for you. And so for just a fun little presentation, I just wanted to show you the basic communication between the PLC and HMI. So these are some tags with the physical addresses in our PLC. So X18 is the physical input, physical output, and then we have some memory bits. We're going to control a water tank based on that. So I'm going to stop sharing real quick, or actually, I want. I want to establish a connection via USB. This is the whole point of the Windows Mobile Center. This is so you can actually connect to the HMI via USB. If you're going to do it via Ethernet, you can. So we're going to download the project to the XPanel. So now it's going to change to this water tank function. And then I have this SciCon as well. So this is the project that it's going to be communicating with. So you can see that M100 is the tank level. X18 is going to be our start and stop feature. And we have an M1 bit to reset everything. And then it's just going to be on a loop increasing up and down. So I'm going to connect option. I'm going to go to USB. Yes, online link download. And right now it's communicating with a PLC inside the hybrid that's already there. So based on the hybrid, it's going to start filling up and down in accordance with that PLC's logic. So this is the control being on and off. And then this is going to reset it to zero whenever I want it to reset it to zero. And this is all being controlled by the HMI. And then this is changing the logic inside the PLC to do what it's being told to do. So if I wanted to tell it to drain instead of fill, I can click this and it'll tell it to drain. And then it'll drain all the way until the bottom. If you want it to start filling again, turn it off, turn it back on. It'll start filling. So that is communication via serial with a PLC and an HMI. I'm going to start sharing again. We're almost done. Come on. Okay. So last but not least, we're going to be showing communication with SCADA software. So I have a PLC set up on the other wall of me, and its address is .0.100. What I mean by that is the local. So it's pinging that device right now, and I need it to be communicating with our SCADA. So these values will only show up if they're communicating with data registers D000 and D001. Now on the XPanel itself, you can turn the XPanel into a server. So it's no longer a client at this point. Well, it can be both at once, but we're going to use the server capability. So D000 will be connected to data or D data. This D data is actually going to be just an internal memory bit of anything. Let's just name it demo virtual analog 100 float 16. Or it's going to be 256, and then it's going to be controlling an off and on bit, same tank on both. But this is how you choose the data server, so the D data, and then address D000, which will be 256. And then this will be a digital value. It'll be flicking on and off based on those values. So going back to our CIMON, this is going to on and off, and then this is going to be a tank level. It's supposed to be going to D000, which is an analog value, and then it's supposed to be going to D001, which is a digital value. So when I run this, it'll be communicating with the HMI inside the other room. So right here, if it wasn't communicating, then it wouldn't show up anything. And then one more thing to prove it, I'm going to change the physical addresses of those. So if I change this to be 2, it's not going to recognize it anymore. If I change this to be 3, it's not going to recognize it, and it's going to syntax out. So I'm going to save that, and then I'm going to run it again. And well, it shows the data registers because they're there, but it doesn't show any values because there's nothing associated to those values. So this is no longer controlling that, turning it on and off. So these values do exist on the HMI, but they do not show the ones that I intended to show. So just showing you that the server and the client features of our SCADA versus HMI. Alrighty, that wraps up the presentation today. Let me show you this thank you slide for everyone that came. Here's a phone number for you and some email addresses if you have any further questions. But that would be it for today. And thank you so much for showing up and listening to every bit of the presentation.